Good morning. Welcome to River's Edge Community Church. Thanks so much for joining us for our worship service today. We have the door open so that the smell of the refinished floor won't make us high, but it's a little sticky in here, so if you need to, move closer to the fan and find ways to cool yourself, but we would rather you be a little hot than a little high. So, today we begin a new series, which we are calling A Clear Focus. Now, I explained this in the weekly email, but let me just repeat what I said there. Suppose I had a great joke. I know that's hard to believe, but suppose it's true. So, and suppose my joke went like this. What's blue and yet not very heavy? Now, that's a great question. But how would you feel if I never got to the punchline? Would you be frustrated? I would. See, I love telling a joke, but I hate starting a joke and never getting a chance to finish it. If it's pouring outside, really raining, I always say, I hope the rain keeps up. And then I wait for someone to say why. Why is a very reasonable response to my rather crazy statement. But if they never say why, I'm stuck. I have a great joke, but I can't finish it. Last spring, we started a Sunday school class called Focus on the Bible. It was designed to look at how we are to interpret and understand and apply the commands of the Bible to our lives today. Unfortunately, the class ended before I could share the punchline. The whole reason for the class was to build on a foundation so that we could intelligently interact with several critical biblical passages that speak to our identity as a church. And without those discussions, it will be very hard for us to find our new pastor. But for a host of different reasons, we never got to the punchline. We neither established the foundation nor engaged in those passages. This series, however, seeks to correct that misstep. Here's how. First, we will establish the foundation. How should we interpret and apply the commands in the Bible? That's what we'll be talking about for the next 5 weeks on Sunday mornings. Now, for some of you who are in our first focus group, and for those of you who are in the Sunday school class, this will be a refresher course. And for that, I apologize. But this is such crucial stuff that I hope you'll find it worth hearing again. So I take back my apology. And then in 5 weeks, after we have built the foundation, we will invite all of our members and friends to join a focus group where we will talk about how these things apply to us as we seek my replacement. Our plan now is to have at least 3 different focus groups. 2 will meet on Sunday afternoons, and 1 will meet on a Tuesday night. You will get to choose which focus group works best for your schedule. And these focus groups will meet for either 2 or 3 sessions and will last roughly 2 hours, maybe 2.25 hours each session. Now, without the risk of hyperbole, these focus groups will determine the future of our church to a huge degree. They absolutely will shape who we hire as our next pastor. And they will potentially shape all sorts of other things from that point on. In other words, they are super important. And we are asking you to sacrifice some time and energy to attend these groups, so that you can help us chart a clear focus for the future. So please don't minimize this preaching series or the subsequent focus groups. They are our future. Here's the good news. I believe that by Thanksgiving, we'll have a clear direction for how to go about finding a new pastor. And we will even have begun taking the very first steps to making that happen. The future begins right now. Last spring, I didn't get to share the punchline. Through this preaching series and through our focus groups, we will finally get there. And that is a promise. Need some proof of that? Earlier, I asked the question, what is blue and not very heavy? The answer is obvious, light blue. That's the punchline. Here's the good news. More punchlines are coming. We're glad you're here. Let's recite our faith together. Say it with me. This we believe, that salvation is found in Christ alone, through grace alone, and received by faith alone, and that the Bible alone is our rule for faith and practice. And we believe that all have sinned and have turned their backs on God, their Creator and King. But we also believe that Christ Jesus came into the world to save us. God the Son took on our humanity and became one of us. And he showed us the Father, and he showed us God's love, and he showed us that he is the way, the truth, and the life. And then Jesus went to the cross and died with us, identifying with us fully in our sin and suffering. And he died instead of us, taking our punishment upon his shoulders. And he died for us so that our sins could be forgiven and so that we could be made dearly loved children of God. And we believe that Jesus rose bodily from the dead, that he ascended to the right hand of God the Father Almighty, and that even now he waits for his kingdom to come to earth, so that all things can be put to rights once more. Amen. Craig, come and pray for us, please.
Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, what a blessing to gather together on this beautiful day. We gather because our purpose is to worship, to honor, to praise, and to adore our Creator. Even when unaware, we have a hunger and yearning to worship you, dear Heavenly Lord. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain, worthy to receive power and honor and glory and praise. Now we ask for the Holy Spirit to prepare our hearts for worship, to hear the word and have it penetrate our very being. In the name of our precious Savior, Jesus, who died that we be redeemed. Amen.
Please stand and join us in worship.
Closer, Lord, my heart is set.
You may be seated.
As is our custom on Sundays where we celebrate the Lord's Supper, we like to pray through the Lord's Prayer. Join me as we pray together, and then we'll open it up for you to pray for the concerns of your own heart, and then I will close us at the appropriate time. Let's pray. Father God, hear us, your people, as we gather together to pray to you and to open up our hearts so that you may speak to us. We testify that we are God's people, called by grace to be salt and light in the world. A people who delight in his name.
A people who boast in his character.
And a people who seek his glory.
And we are a people who trust in his goodness and love.
A people who confess our sin and who know we stand continually in the need of forgiveness.
And we are a people who seek God's grace.
And we are a people who gather together to worship. And that is why we pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We know God hears our prayers because
He is our Father, and we are his people, called by grace to be salt and light in the world.
Amen. And my dad will read today's scripture from Proverbs.
Our scripture today is in Proverbs chapter 26, verses 4 and 5. It reads as follows. Do not answer a fool according to his folly, or you yourself will be just like him. Answer a fool according to his folly, or he will be wise in his own eyes. Thus ends the reading of the word for today.
Please stand as we continue our worship.
Through out a sacred page, I see.
You may be seated.
Let us continue our worship by taking up an offering. The offering which we take every Sunday is a way for us to open our hands to God, to allow Him to fill us as we give. God is a gracious giver, and He calls us to be like Him in this regard, that we would bless others through our time, through our talent, and through our giving. At this time, let's dismiss the kids to go downstairs to their class. Let's say the blessing and send them on their way. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make His face shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn His face toward us and give us peace. Kids, you are dismissed. One Friday night, not too long ago, we were playing an icebreaker game at the Edge. It was a variation of the two truths and a lie game, except instead of you writing your two truths and a lie, someone else would write them about you. So everyone got a card with someone else's name on it, and they began writing down two truths and a lie about that person. Now, I prefer not to play these games so that I can interact with our students as they are playing and not get so caught up in the game itself. But for some reason, my name was handed out and someone started writing down two truths and a lie about me. But a couple people had not arrived yet, and I wanted to make sure when they got there, they could play. So I backed out of the game. My card was taken from the person who got my name, and the game continued. Later that evening, I stumbled upon my card, and I looked at it. The person had written one line about me. They wrote, "This person loves Jesus." But now, I was in a quandary. The person who wrote this, was this one of their true statements about me, or was it their lie? Weisenheimer, thy name is the edge. If we were playing this game this morning, I hope that you would know these two truths about me. I love Jesus, and I love the Bible. In fact, you could even write that I grew up in a home where these two truths were very, very evident. They were so evident, matter of fact, that many of our dinner table conversations were about Jesus and the Bible. And that's why when I was just 8 or 9, I professed Jesus as my Lord and Savior. It just was a natural development of everything that was going on. Not only that, but church was always a huge part of my life, as was reading books on theology. And so when it came time to pick a college, I chose one where I could major both in communications and in the Bible. And my first job after college used both of those skills. I worked at a Christian video publishing house as a videotape editor, a production director, and as a curriculum writer. And it was in that job that I really first discovered that I loved teaching the Bible. Now, if you are really serious about teaching the Bible, you really ought to go to seminary. So off we went. And seminary was great fun. Not only did it enhance my spiritual life, but it gave me an even deeper love for the Bible. One day in seminary, one of my professors suggested to the whole class that we all ought to pick one subject and study it extensively so that when we retire, we could honestly say we were an expert in that field. That sounded like a great idea, but I couldn't really figure out what subject to choose. But then years later, I was teaching at Chesapeake Theological Seminary, and one of our professors needed to back out of teaching a class at the last minute. And so I was elected to teach it. The class was Principles of Biblical Interpretation. I had finally found my subject. And for the next 30 years, I read almost everything I could afford on how to interpret the Bible. I also found out that I loved teaching others how to interpret the Bible. And that, in a nutshell, is the story of my life. Martin Luther once said, "The Bible is alive. It speaks to me. It has feet. It runs after me. It has hands. It lays hold of me." I get that. I get that completely. And I would have said those very same words, except Luther beat me to it by 500 years. All that to say, I love Jesus and I love the Bible. And I take my relationship with Jesus and the Bible very seriously. Now, why am I telling you all of this? Why? Because I might say some things in this series that may sound like I don't take the Bible very seriously. But I want you to know right up front, that is not true. I do take the Bible very seriously, which I would argue means taking the Bible as it was intended to be understood. But that means that sometimes what the Bible seems to be saying is not what it was intending to convey. You read Genesis 1, and it looks like the world was created in 6 literal days. Or you read Genesis 5, and it looks like people back then had very, very, very long lives. And if you read Genesis 6, it looks like the flood was a global catastrophe. But that is not how the original author intended these things to be understood. Now, there was a time in my life when I believed each of those things, because that is what a straightforward, literal reading of the Bible said. But I had confused what the Bible said with what the Bible was intending to convey. Maybe G.K. Chesterton can help us here. He once said, "The word good has many meanings. For example, if a man were to shoot his grandmother at a range of 500 yards, I should call him a good shot, but not necessarily a good man." Here's the point. Just because the Bible says something doesn't mean that we should take it in its most literal sense. Or to say it a little crassly, perhaps, the Bible is not as clear or as unambiguous as it may appear. There used to be a very popular saying, "The Bible says it, I believe it, and that settles it for me." And while I still appreciate the commitment to the Bible that saying promotes, it's extremely misleading. Why? Well, first, nobody does everything the Bible says. And by nobody, I mean you. Let me quote 3 verses to prove that point. Leviticus 19:32, "Stand up in the presence of the aged." John 13:14, "Wash one another's feet." 1 Thessalonians 5:26, "Greet all God's people with a holy kiss." The Bible says it, yet when I came up here this morning, no one stood, no one washed my feet, and no one, not even Joe, kissed me. Now, the Bible said it, but we don't do it, at least not literally. But that's okay. I really don't want you to think that I am so old that you need to stand. And I don't really want you to wash or even touch my feet. And frankly, I'd rather most of you not kiss me, especially those of you who have beards. And the saying is misleading because it makes the Bible sound obvious and uncomplicated. But that's simply not true. The fact is, understanding what the Bible says is a lot more complicated and messier than we normally think. But that's not what we have been taught. We've been taught sola scriptura, that the Bible is our only rule for faith and practice. And while that is true, the fact is that the scripture we believe in is never alone. It always requires interpretation. Everything we read, from simple statements on people's ages in Genesis to complex things like identifying the beast in the book of Revelation, always require interpretation. Always require interpretation. Always. Why? Because most of the Bible is far from clear. Now, take a breath and remember, I love Jesus and I love the Bible. Plus, I'm saying things that you already know are true in your heart, even if you haven't said them out loud. Now, I'm not saying that everything is up for grabs. Of course not. But many things, even some of the main things, aren't as clear as we often think they are. Let me see if I can prove that to you. Let's look at how the three great leaders of the Reformation, Luther, Calvin, Zwingli, understood two key doctrines. We could look at many, many more, but for the sake of time, these two will have to do. Let's start with the Lord's Supper. That's appropriate for today. And I think we would all agree that this is an important teaching of the Bible and an essential spiritual practice. Here's the question. Where is Jesus when we partake of the elements? Well, for Luther, it was clear. Jesus had said in Luke, "This is my body." So that must mean that the real presence of Jesus is in, with, and under the bread and the wine that we partake. This is his body. Calvin read the same passage, but he believed that Jesus meant that he was always spiritually present, not physically, but spiritually present in the sacrament. Zwingli would have none of it. He understood it to be saying that the bread and the wine represent what Jesus did for us. And therefore, the Lord's Supper is a type of memorial meal where we remember Jesus' sacrifice for us. But is Jesus actually present in some unique way in the sacraments, according to Zwingli? No, not at all. Question: how can the three great minds of the Reformation have such dramatically different ideas about something so essential to our spiritual lives? Answer: because the Bible is just not as clear here as we would like. Let's ask how these three understood the heart of the gospel. Well, that should be pretty easy. It should be straightforward. And yet, no. For Luther, the heart of the gospel was justification by faith. For Calvin, it was the glory of God. For Zwingli, it was the grace of God. Was the problem that these three men didn't believe in the doctrine of sola scriptura? Of course not. It was that they couldn't agree with what the Bible was saying. They all believed that our Bible is the only rule for faith and practice, but they couldn't agree what the scriptures were teaching about our faith and practice. And that's also true about us today. In 2010, the Atlas of Global Christianity estimated that there are more than 38,000 different denominations in the world. In other words, there are at least 38,000 different understandings of what Scripture says that are significant enough to cause some sort of division. Holy moly, that's a lot of cannoli. 38,000 different denominations. But let's not just stop there. Several Christian publishers have produced book series that feature evangelical scholars, scholars that we would most certainly agree that they are on our side, that they speak our language. And these scholars face off with each other in this book series over what the Bible teaches. Now, you would think that there might be a few rather interesting, but not essential topics that could be debated, but not so. Instead, there are a lot of very important topics where evangelicals, people like us, have very different understandings. Very different. Here's a partial list of some of the books in these series. We have Five Views on Justification, Five Views on Sanctification, Four Views on the Role of Works, Four Views on Eternal Security, Four Views on Biblical Inerrancy, Four Views on How to Understand and Apply the Bible Today, Three Views on Creation and Evolution, 3 views on the historicity of the Gospels, 4 views on the historical Adam, 4 views on hell, 4 views on war, because war is hell, 4 views on the Apostle Paul, 5 views on the law and the gospel, 4 views on women in ministry, 5 views on the church and politics, 5 views on Christianity and psychology, 4 views on Christianity and science, 4 views on Christianity and philosophy, and if that was not enough, we have 4 views on the doctrine of God. We can't even agree on our doctrine of God. Bottom line, people may agree about Scripture alone, but they certainly don't agree about what Scripture says. What was it that George Bernard Shaw said? No man ever believes that the Bible means what it says. He is always convinced that it says what he means. In other words, the Bible is not some simple Sunday school book that we simply open up, read, and that settles it. It is far more complicated than that. Far more. Everything must be interpreted. Everything must be set in its proper context. And everything must be evaluated and assessed and seen in its proper light. In short, to fully grasp what the Bible is saying to us today, we need considerable amount of godly wisdom and discernment. That's why many scholars argue that the best model for reading the Bible is the book of Proverbs. Take our text, for example. Proverbs 26:4 says, "Do not answer a fool according to his folly, or you yourself will be just like him." What does this verse say? Easy. When you are out and about and you encounter a fool, don't play his game. Don't stoop to his level and get into a shouting match. Instead, just walk away. Because if you engage him, you'll end up looking as foolish as he is. Simple. Except that the very next verse, says the exact opposite. It says, "Answer a fool according to his folly, or he will be wise in his own eyes." And all God's people said, "What the heck? What are we supposed to do? Answer or not answer?" Welcome to how the Bible works. We can't just read the Bible and do what it says, because if we do, every time we turn around, someone will be either standing up or washing someone's feet or giving a kiss to someone. You got to interpret everything. Instead, when we read the Bible, we need godly wisdom and discernment so that we can know what the Bible is intending to communicate and how we are to apply it to our lives today. For instance, here, we need to discern at least 3 things. We need to discern the nature of the fool with whom we are dealing. Is this someone who will just pull us into a quagmire of worthless banter? Or is she someone who might possibly hear what we are saying and take it to heart, even if that happens years from now? And we also have to discern the audience and ask, are there people around us who might overhear our conversation and possibly benefit from our discussion? In other words, we need to discern the likelihood of our comments bearing spiritual fruit. If the likelihood is low or non-existent, don't answer the fool. But if there is a chance, go for it. And we also have to discern the situation. Maybe if there is a lot at stake, we need to answer the fool. Maybe if there isn't, we can just let it go. Jesus, on trial before Pilate, discerned the situation and chose to be silent. Paul, on the other hand, when he was on trial before King Agrippa, chose to defend himself. Both discerned the situation and spoke accordingly. And that is how most of the Bible works. We just don't read and then do whatever it says. We read, interpret, set everything in its proper context, and then discern what we should do so that we can respond accordingly. And we do that because the Bible is not a rule book. It's a wisdom book. It guides us into the truth as we seek to do God's will in our day by following the pattern and principles set down before us in the text. But you say, true, that's how Proverbs works, but that's not how the rest of the Bible works. Really? Let's just look at one topic. Let's look at divorce. What does the Bible say about divorce? Well, let's start with Jesus. In Mark 10, Jesus says, anyone who divorces his wife and marries another woman commits adultery with her. In other words, no divorce, no exceptions, case closed. But wait, Jesus in Matthew 5 offers an exception. Why Mark doesn't include an exception and Matthew does, even though Matthew uses Mark as his main source, is anyone's guess. In any case, back to Matthew. In Matthew 5, Jesus says, but I tell you that anyone who divorces his wife, except for sexual immorality, makes her the victim of adultery, and anyone who marries a divorced woman commits adultery. Here, divorce is permitted if sexual immorality is involved. Now, the case is closed. But wait, Paul offers yet another exception. He says in 1 Corinthians 7, to the married, I give this command, not I, but the Lord. A wife must not separate from her husband, but if she does, she must remain unmarried or else be reconciled to her husband. And a husband must not divorce his wife. Here, Paul is saying just what Jesus said in Matthew and in Mark. But then Paul goes on, to the rest, I say this, I, not the Lord, I'm not quoting Jesus here, I'm just using my own wisdom and discernment. If any brother has a wife who is not a believer, and she is willing to live with him, he must not divorce her. But if the unbeliever leaves, let it be so. The brother or sister is not bound in such circumstances. In other words, if an unbeliever wants to divorce a believing partner, then that's okay. And the believer is not bound by that marriage anymore. Case closed. So we have these two biblical grounds for divorce: sexual immorality, aka adultery, and abandonment. Except there's also Ezra. After a particularly moving sermon by Ezra, the people respond saying, we have disobeyed God by marrying these foreign women. Therefore, we must promise God that we will divorce our foreign wives and send them away together with their children. So now I guess there are three exceptions. But what if a husband is abusing his wife physically? Can she divorce her husband? It's not adultery, and it's not abandonment, and it's not a case of allowing foreign wives to lead you into worshiping their gods, in which case, see 1 Corinthians 7. So technically, according to the Bible, according to the letter of the law, no, she can't divorce him. But spousal abuse is never mentioned directly in the Bible. In other words, the issue never once came up. And as such, it is very similar to what Paul is dealing with in 1 Corinthians 7. The whole issue of unbelievers divorcing their believing spouses was something brand new. It had never once been talked about in the Bible. And so Paul had to discern God's will for this situation, even though no one had ever considered anything like it before. So what did Paul do? He studied how God acted in other situations. And he concluded that God always sided with the weak and helpless, that God was always concerned for justice and faithfulness and love, and that God always was concerned for the victim. And Paul looked to see why God allowed divorce in the case of adultery, and concluded if the marriage covenant was broken beyond all repair, then divorce could be permitted for the good of the less guilty party. And while nothing mandates divorce, because grace and healing are always possible, he argued that the believer was not bound to a marriage if the unbeliever left. Why? Because abandonment was breaking the marriage covenant beyond all repair. So, what do? We apply these same principles. And if we do that, I believe we will conclude that abuse does such violence to the marriage covenant that divorce should be permitted for the healing and help of all involved, even though the Bible never stipulates it explicitly as a legitimate reason. We look for the principles involved and follow the patterns of justice that runs throughout the whole Bible, principles and patterns that say abuse breaks the marriage covenant beyond all repair and therefore is allowed. In other words, we discern what to do by applying godly wisdom to the situation. And where do we get this wisdom? We read the stories of the Bible. Does that make sense? But again, you already know all of this. Most commands in the Bible have an exception, another command that actually negates the first command. And that second command cries out to us to glean wisdom so that we can discern what to do. For example, we are to accept one another. That's absolutely true. We are called to accept one another. But we are also called to admonish one another. How do I know what to do? You say something stupid. Should I accept you or should I admonish you? Answer, it takes wisdom and discernment. And yes, we are to agree with one another and even honor one another above ourselves, but we are also to instruct one another. So do I go along to get along, or do I step in and graciously impart some much-needed correction? And yes, Paul directs us to be patient with everyone. But he also says, warn a divisive person once, and then warn them a second time, and after that have nothing to do with them. How do I know when to be patient? How do I know when to say enough is enough? I'm walking away. And the answer is, it all depends. Because the Bible is not a rule book. It is a wisdom book that requires that we discern God's will for us today by interpreting what the Bible says in its original context, comparing it to our context today, and then with all the godly wisdom we have, we must seek to live out the principles in the text in our lives today. And that means reading the Bible is far more complicated and difficult than what we have come to believe. And I say that as someone who loves the Bible. Yes, the Bible is not always clear and straightforward, but it is still rich and powerful, and it shows us Jesus. And you can't ask for anything better than that. Years ago, we were at a missions conference where a pastor from some Eastern European country, I can't remember what country, kept on repeating this wonderful refrain. It was years and years and years ago, but I've never forgotten that refrain. He took his Bible and said over and over and over again, this book, the power of God is in this book, the Bible. He could not have been more right. The power of God is in this book. And for someone who loves Jesus and loves the Bible, that is great news. Let's pray. We'll talk more about the Bible and how it relates to us as we begin this search for our next pastor next week. Let's pray. Father God, You have blessed us by giving us the Bible. And yet it is a struggle sometimes to understand exactly what it is saying. And so we pray that you would give us wisdom and discernment so that we can live out your truth to the best of our understanding in a way that glorifies your name and fills us with joy. Lead us into the truth. Teach us so that we would know that you are with us. And teach us to love one another, for this is your great command to all of us. As we come to this table, while there is confusion about certain details, we know the truth is very clear. You came, you took on our humanity, you lived among us, and you died with us and for us and instead of us. And you gave us this meal and said, take, eat, remember. As we come to this table, may we remember and may we encounter you and commune with you and find the richness that comes from walking with you. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
As we contemplate the sacrament, please join us in song.
The blessing of God. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom, and as you sing psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit with gratitude in your hearts to God. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him.
Give thanks to God, as one approved, the Lord.
I wait for the Lord. My whole being waits, and in his word I put my hope. Israel, put your hope in the Lord, for with the Lord is unfailing love, and with him is full redemption. God bless you. Have a great, great week. Amen.